Let's open our Bibles to the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter number 1. Revelation, as we get into this book. Now, I want to look at verse number 3 to start things off, rather than verse number 1. We'll get back to verse number 1 in a minute. Now, Revelation is an interesting book for a lot of different reasons. But one of the things that's interesting about it is there's a special blessing placed upon those that would read, study, and live according to the book of Revelation. Now, we will look at verse number 3 almost every time that we gather together to study the book. Now, verse number 3 says this: "Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand." And so he places a special blessing. First of all, he says, "Blessed is he that readeth." If you read the words of this prophecy, there's a lot of different times I have people come to me and say, "Pastor Thomas, you know, where should I start reading my Bible? You know, I either haven't really been faithful to read it, or I've kind of been out of it for a while and I want to get back into reading and studying the Bible. Where should I start?" And I encourage them to start with the book of Revelation. And it's exciting. And you get into the book of Revelation, you spend some time reading, and you're going to have some questions. You know, you start off with the book of Revelation, there's going to be a lot of things that are kind of puzzling. A lot of things that seem kind of bizarre and kind of weird. But as you make your way through the book of Revelation, I encourage people, just jot down the questions you have, jot down the phrases and the verses and the things that you just don't understand, and just kind of make note of those things. And then go back to the very beginning, go back to Genesis, and start at Genesis 1:1 and read through and make your way back to the book of Revelation, because those questions and those little mysteries and secrets will be kind of unveiled to you as you read and study the rest of the Bible. I mean, it's so important. If we're going to read and know and understand what Revelation has to say, we're going to have an understanding of the rest of what Scripture has to say, because so many quotes and phrases and types and pictures are taken from elsewhere in the Bible. And so you jot those things down, and then as you make your way back to the book of Revelation and you read through it again, a lot of those questions and those types and illustrations will become a lot clearer to you. And then you'll have new questions and new puzzling things that you kind of want to look at. And as you make your way through the Scriptures, once again, those things will be open, they'll be revealed to you. But I encourage people to start right here in this book. Read Revelation. There's a special blessing placed upon those that would read the book of Revelation. That's not said of a lot of other books of the Bible. And so he says, "Blessed is he that readeth." Then he says, "Blessed are they that hear the words of this prophecy." And so this is not just a hearing like in one ear and out the other. I've told my wife a number of years ago, I said, "Now if I'm watching football, I'm watching basketball, some sporting event is on TV, that is not the time to give me important information. Because I won't hear. I will not remember what it is you're trying to tell me." Just the other day, my wife and I were sitting there, and she's talking to me, and you know, I got a little notification on my phone or something, and something's going on, and I, you know, all of a sudden my mind is not focused in on what my wife is saying anymore. Now my mind is focused on what my phone says. And so a few minutes later, I asked her a question about something, and she said, "Weren't you listening to what I was trying to tell you?" I was, and then I got distracted. You know, in one ear, did I hear and know that she was talking audibly? Yes, I did. But did I understand the message? No, I did not. Now, when he says, "Blessed are they that hear the words of this prophecy," he's talking about having an understanding. He wants us to understand. I remember a few years ago, I was watching a well-known pastor of a very large Southern Baptist church out on the East Coast, and he was talking about the book of Revelation, and he was saying, I don't understand anything about the book of Revelation. I just don't get it. And I think, how sad is that? Because God wants us to know. There's a special blessing for those that would know what the book of Revelation has to say. You know, all throughout the scriptures, he's talking about prophecy. He says, I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren. I don't want you to be caught unaware. I want you to know. He gives us the timeline. And for those that truly know him as their Savior, they have a relationship with him. He wants us to know what's going on. He doesn't want to come as a thief in the night for us. He wants us to be aware of what's happening in our world around us. He wants to know the day, the time, the season that we're living in. And he says there's a special blessing, not just for somebody who will read through it, but somebody who will actually take time to study the book of Revelation and to know what it says, to know what the message is and what God's trying to reveal. And so there's a blessing for those that would read it and a blessing for those that would understand it. He says there's a blessing for those that would keep those things which are written therein. And so we read the book, we study it, we gain an understanding, but that's not where it ought to end. It's good for us to read, it's good for us to study and take notes and have the information, but we're not just trying to gain information for information's sake. We're trying to gain information so that we can do something with it. He wants us to apply it to the way that we live our lives. So as I read Revelation and as I study it and gain an understanding of what God is saying and what he's going to do, it ought to change the way that I live my life. A little later on in the book of Revelation, we see that John is giving a scroll and he's told to eat it. Now, it's not literally eating it. It's not tearing pages out of the Bible, wadding it up, and consuming it. No, he wants us to understand what the message is. And John says, when I began to eat this scroll, now, Ezekiel had the same thing happen to him. He's given a scroll written on both sides, which was a special scroll. And we'll get to that later on in Revelation. But he's given a special scroll, and he's told to eat it. He says, when I ate it, it's sweet to my mouth like honey. Same circumstance and experience that John had. It's sweet to my taste in my mouth like honey. And man, prophecy's like that. Prophecy is exciting. You know, we like to talk about all the different possibilities of what's going to happen, the coming one world leader, the false prophet, the two witnesses, the one world religion, and we like to go through and talk about, you know, the great asteroids coming down, the giant hailstones, and everything else that's going to happen, water turning into blood, and it's kind of exciting to talk about the players on the world stage and how things are going to shape up in this scenario and that scenario, and it's exciting, sweet to the taste. But both John and Ezekiel said as it got down to their belly and they began to digest the message, it was bitter to their stomach. And that's the way the book of Revelation, that's the way that prophecy ought to be for someone who really understands it. Yes, it's exciting to talk about. And we come back to this subject every so many years. I try to come back. 4 years ago on Sunday nights, we went verse by verse like we're doing now through the book of Revelation. And now Sunday mornings in our morning life group class, we're going verse by verse through the book of Revelation. It's exciting. And it stirs people's interest for the scriptures and the things of God. But when we really digest what the message is, that God is going to pour out his wrath on mankind, that ought to be bitter to our stomach. That ought to be a little upsetting to us. And so that ought to change the way that we live our lives when I understand the message and what he's saying. And one of the things that he says is, for the time is at hand, that is very short. We don't have a long time. At any moment, these events could kick off and God would pour out his wrath on mankind. So that ought to change the way that I live my life. That ought to change the way that I reach out to the lost in my community. My friends, my neighbors, my co-workers, my family members, those that I care about, ought to be taking the truth of the gospel that Jesus Christ is the only way of salvation. We ought to be calling out a warning that judgment is coming, danger is ahead. You can find salvation through the Lord Jesus Christ. You can find safety through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. It ought to change the way that we live. Once we come to an understanding, we've read it, we've studied it, we understand what the prophecy is and what God is going to do, man, that ought to stir up something within us to witness to everyone who's around us that they might avoid the danger that is to come. And so he promises this special blessing for those that would read it, those that would hear it, those that would act upon what the message of Revelation is. And we're going to try to do that as we make our way through the book of Revelation. And so we claim this special blessing here. Now, before we jump back to verse number one, let's have a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time that we can study the book of Revelation. We thank you for revealing these truths to us, for the Holy Spirit of God, who is our teacher. Lord, I pray that you'd give us understanding about what this book says. Lord, we want to claim the blessing for those that read it and understand it and live according to what this book says. So we pray that you would work in our hearts and lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, we've looked at verse number three. Now let's go back and look at the beginning. Now the very first thing that we see in verse number one, it tells us the revelation of Jesus Christ. Now that is the true title of this book. Now you may have a wrong title in your Bible, like my Bible here says the revelation of St. John the Divine. That's not the title of the book. The title of the book is the revelation of Jesus Christ. He is the one who is being revealed here. It's not John who is being revealed. It's the Lord Jesus Christ and his plan and purpose that is being revealed. And so that is the true title of the book. And your publisher may have got the title wrong, as mine did. But it's the revelation or the revealing of Jesus Christ. Now that word revelation is where we get our English word apocalypse. And that's often what the end times are called. You know, the apocalypse is upon us. What's that mean? It's the unveiling. It's the revealing. And it's the unveiling and revealing of who? It's the Lord Jesus Christ. And so it is the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him. And so you notice that God is revealing some things about and to the Lord Jesus Christ. He's opening up the plan. Now, there was a time where Jesus did not know God's timeline. He did not know God's plan. Turn with me back to the book of Mark, chapter number 13. Mark chapter number 13. Now, as the Lord Jesus Christ was here on this earth, of course, he was God in the flesh. His deity was kind of suppressed and veiled willingly of himself. But notice what he tells his followers here in Mark chapter number 13. And let's see here. Let's begin reading in verse number 19. We'll read a little bit of scripture here. He says, "For in those days shall be affliction such as was not from the beginning of the creation which God created unto this time, neither shall be." Now verse 20, "And except that the Lord had shortened those days, no flesh should be saved. But for the elect's sake, whom he had chosen, he has shortened the days. And then if any man shall say to you, lo, here is Christ, or lo, he is there, believe him not. For false Christs and false prophets shall rise and shall show signs and wonders to seduce, if it were possible, even the elect. But take ye heed, behold, I have foretold you all things." Now, notice there, God wants him to know. He wants them to know and understand what's going on in these end time events. He doesn't want to surprise his followers. He said, "I've told you all things." And so he says, "But in those days," verse 24, "after that tribulation, the sun shall be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars of heaven shall fall, and the powers that are in heaven shall be shaken. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory. And then shall he send his angels, and shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from the uttermost part of the earth to the uttermost part of heaven. Now learn a parable of the fig tree. When her branch is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, ye know that summer is near. So ye in like manner, when ye shall see these things come to pass, know that it is nigh, even at the doors. Verily I say unto you that this generation shall not pass till all these things be done. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. And here's what we want to look at, verse 32. He says, but of that day and that hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels which are in heaven, neither the Son, but the Father. Take ye heed, watch and pray, for ye know not when the time is. So he says that the Father is the only one who knows at this point when he is speaking. He says, but of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels. The angels don't know. The Son doesn't know, but the Father is the only one that knows. And so, of course, this is before the Lord Jesus Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. And so while he is in that human flesh, he's not yet been exalted and glorified, he did not know the timeline. But there's a time here after his resurrection and exaltation that the timeline is revealed to him. I don't think that there's anything that the Lord Jesus Christ does not know today. He sees and knows all things. You know, I hear different preachers, you know, stand up and say, well, even Jesus Christ doesn't know, he does know now. It's been revealed to him. He knows all things. And so this is the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him. And so in his glorified and exalted form, he does know. He knows all things at this point. So he knows right now when the time is going to be where God's going to say, hey, I want you to go down and get those who know you as their Savior. It's time to begin these end time events. He knows right now what's going to happen. But it's the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him, to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. So God revealed it to Jesus Christ, and he wanted Jesus to reveal it to his servants. He does want us to know. He does want us to understand what's going to happen, the timeline and everything else. So if I don't know it and I don't understand it, it's not his fault. It's my fault that I haven't taken time to study it and to learn what the Bible has to say and what God is going to do. And he says they're going to shortly come to pass. And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. And so he's going to deliver the message to John to write down and declare what's going to happen. Verse 2 tells us a little bit about John, who bare record of the word of God and of the testimony of Jesus Christ and of all things that he saw. He was a witness to everything that the Lord Jesus Christ had said and done, how he lived his life here on this earth, his death, burial, resurrection. And he saw and witnessed all of those things. And he recorded those things for us to see and to read. And then we get to verse number 3 that we've looked at already. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. So these things, as he says in verse number 1, are going to come shortly to pass. Why? Because the time is at hand. We are living in the last days. At any moment, these events could be triggered. John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, and we'll hear more about those seven churches in chapters 2 and 3. He says, John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace from him which is and which was and which is to come and from the seven spirits which are before his throne. So John has a message to these seven churches that he's going to deliver. And he opens it up by saying grace and peace. And those are things that are only found through the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace is the unmerited favor, the good things that we do not deserve. That's what salvation is. For by grace are ye saved through faith. He says not only grace, but peace. Before we come to know Jesus Christ as our Savior, we're at war with God. We are his enemy. There is no peace in our hearts and lives. Jesus Christ, as the Prince of Peace, is the only one that can give us peace. And he says, grace and peace to this church from him which is and which was and which is to come. That's talking about God the Father. And he says, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne. Now that is a way to describe the Holy Spirit of God. So you've got grace and peace from God the Father, grace and peace from the Holy Spirit. And that title, seven spirits, is a reference back to Isaiah chapter number 11. Isaiah chapter number 11 gives the full description of the Holy Spirit. Look at Isaiah chapter 11. Verse number 1 says, and there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots, and the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. Now, notice how it chooses to describe the Spirit of the Lord. The Spirit of wisdom and understanding. The Spirit of counsel and might. The Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. And that is a full description of the Holy Spirit as referenced in Revelation chapter 1 and verse number 4, when it talks about the seven spirits and those seven distinct things about who He is. And He says, not only from God the Father, not only from the Holy Spirit, but verse 5, and from Jesus Christ. And so you have grace and peace from the Trinity, the complete Godhead here. And it tells us that Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. And so he tells us here and describes the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the first begotten of the dead. He died, He paid the price for our sins, and He rose again from the dead. If He did not rise again, Paul tells us in the Corinthians, that we're still lost in our sins. That we are still, of all men, most miserable, because there is no salvation without the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Unless He conquers death, we cannot have eternal life. He's the first begotten of the dead. And He is the Prince of the kings of earth. He is the King of kings and Lord of lords, as the Scripture tells us. Unto Him that, and notice what it says, He loved us and washed us from our sins in His own blood. And I don't understand why He loves us. I don't understand why He loves me. I may never understand, but I'm thankful for it. And He showed that love to us. Romans 5:8, God commendeth His love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. John tells us that greater love hath no man than this, than a man lay down his life for his friends. Then he says, you are my friends. He laid down his life for us. He loved us, and he washed us from our sins in his own blood. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. Jesus and his sacrifice is the only way of salvation. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me, Jesus Christ said. He said, I am the door. He's the only way. If you come any other way, you're a thief and a robber. You have to come through the Lord Jesus Christ. He washed us from our sins in His own blood and hath made us kings and priests. Peter had something to say about this in 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 and 10. He says, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of Him who hath called you out of darkness into His marvelous light, which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have attained mercy. He says, you weren't a people, but now you are. Why? Because we've been washed from our sins by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. He said, we are a royal priesthood. And that's exactly what he says here in verse 6. He's made us kings and priests unto God and His Father. To Him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Verse 7 continues on. Behold, He cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see Him, and they also which pierced Him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of Him. Even so, amen. Now there's going to be a time where He's going to come, and only those who know Him as Savior will see Him. We often call that the rapture. The Greek word is the harpazo. Rapture is in the Latin, where He's going to come just for the saints. And then here, there's going to be a time where He doesn't come for the saints, He comes with His saints. And at that time, He's going to come in the clouds, and every eye shall see Him. And we think of Matthew 26, verse number 64. Jesus saith unto him, Thou hast said, Nevertheless I say unto you, Hereafter shall ye see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven. Matthew 24, 30. Then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they, who's they? All the tribes of the earth shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he also notes, and he says, And they also which pierced him, a reference to Zechariah chapter number 12, and verse number 10, where the Bible says, And I will pour upon the house of David and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and supplications. And they shall look upon me whom they have pierced, and they shall mourn for him as one mourneth for his only son, and shall be in bitterness for him as one that is in bitterness for his firstborn. Now, he here is referencing a specific event that has taken place. Now, when he talks about they also which pierced him, he's referring to the children of Israel. Now, as we get started, and I want to talk to you about this, I want to make sure that you understand that it wasn't the Jews specifically who murdered Jesus. It's not their fault. Okay, Jesus died for my sins. He died for your sins. My sins are what nailed him to that tree. Your sins. Some have taken these verses and have blamed the Jews and have used it to do all kinds of horrible atrocities to them. That's not what we're talking about here today, because I know my sins put him there. But he does have a specific message to the children of Israel because they rejected him as Messiah. He came, and there was a certain time and a certain day where he rides into Jerusalem on that donkey. We often call it the triumphal entry. We celebrate that on Palm Sunday. The triumphal entry. Remember where he rides into town on this donkey. They put the branches and everything out in front of him. They're crying, Hosanna to the Son of David. And they're singing this messianic psalm about the Messiah, the Savior of the world that would come. And you remember how the religious leaders of that day said, hey, you need to tell your disciples, you need to tell your followers, this multitude, to be quiet. That's blasphemy. You remember what Jesus said? He said, listen, if these should hold their peace, even the rocks could cry out. Now, that's not something that would happen at any moment, any day. You know, you hear different people talk about, if we won't praise him, the rocks will cry out. No, they won't. Jesus said that because that was a specific prophecy that had to be fulfilled from Daniel chapter number 9. There was a specific timeline down to the very day where the Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah, would present himself as the King, as the spotless Lamb. And it was only on that day that he presented himself. If they would not declare him, then the rocks would cry out. But remember, that was just something that they did outwardly. They were not looking for a Savior. They were looking for a spiritual Savior. They're looking for a political Savior. Someone who would overthrow the government and would establish, once again, a kingdom there in Israel for the Jewish people. And later on that day, as Jesus is looking over the multitudes, he begins to weep. And he begins to cry. And you know the reason he's crying is because they don't recognize who he is. They do not recognize him as the Messiah, as the Savior that would come. He says, man, behold the things that I would do for you. But now they are hid from your eyes. Now only hid for a short time and a season. But they're hid from your eyes. You remember as Jesus was there and he was being presented in front of the people. Pilate said, behold, your king, the king of the Jews. You remember what they said, we have no king but Caesar. They rejected, they said, his blood be upon us and our children. They rejected the Messiah. And that's what this tribulation time is all about. It's about restoring the people of Israel back to their Savior. Hosea chapter number 5 tells us that the Lord Jesus will not come back until they acknowledge their offense. It's a very specific offense. It's rejecting Jesus Christ as the Messiah. And that's what they have done, and that's what he's referencing here. He's referencing their rejection of Jesus Christ as Messiah, and they are going to look on him, and they're going to see on him, just as Zechariah chapter number 12 says. They're going to acknowledge their offense in Hosea chapter number 5. We'll get to that, all that later on in the book. And it says, "And all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him, even so, amen." "I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, saith the Lord, which is and which was and which is to come, the Almighty." And here we find that phrase, Alpha and Omega. We find it four times in the New Testament. All of them occur in the book of Revelation, twice here in the first chapter, and then as you get on to the last two chapters, we'll find that phrase and that title again. And we need to note that God is outside of time, and He is which is and which was and which is to come. He's not bound by our physical properties, and time is a physical property. And verse 9 says, "I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation and the kingdom and in patience of Jesus Christ, was in the isle that is called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ." Now, here John is suffering under the Roman reign of Domitian, and history and tradition tells us that he was boiled in a pot of oil as well, was put into exile here on the Isle of Patmos. He suffered for the Word of God, for the testimony of Jesus Christ, and somehow as Americans we think that we're going to escape what most Christians for most of time has had to endure, and that is persecution. We have been very fortunate. God has been gracious to us. But I believe the time is coming very soon where we will have to choose to suffer for the Lord Jesus Christ or to reject His name. And he says that I'm your brother and companion in tribulation. He says, verse 10, "I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day." Now that's not Sunday. There's no evidence at all in Scripture that Sunday is called the Lord's day. Most likely here, this was the Sabbath day, but even that's not what he's referring to. I believe he's referring to the day of the Lord that is prophesied throughout the Scriptures, that end time, day of judgment and time of judgment, where God is going to pour out His wrath on mankind. I don't think it's just some vision that John sees here, some dream that God gives. Remember, God's outside of time. He can do whatever He wants to do. And I believe He takes John and He transports him into the future, to this day of the Lord, to this time of judgment, to see and hear and witness everything that takes place and to record those things for us. And he is transported to that day of the Lord. So when he says, "I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day," it's not some sort of Sunday celebration. There is no support in Scripture for Sunday being the Lord's day. And that is a tradition that the Roman church started. But he says, "And heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet." So there's this loud blast. It's not that he's hearing a trumpet. It's a loud voice that grabs his attention, just as someone were to blast the trumpet behind you would get your attention. And so this loud voice grabs his attention, and it tells us here, saying, "I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, and what thou seest, write in a book, and send it unto the seven churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus, and unto Smyrna, and unto Pergamos, and unto Thyatira, and unto Sardis, and unto Philadelphia, and unto Laodicea." So once again, we have this title, "I am Alpha and Omega." Now, I want you to write down in a book a message to seven churches. Now, we're going to get into what he has to say to these seven churches as we get into chapters 2 and 3. That's important information to us. Chapters 2 and 3 are the most important parts of the book of Revelation for us. The rest of it, yeah, it's good information to have. We ought to read it, we ought to know it, understand it, and live accordingly. But as far as our Christian life is concerned, the most important thing for us is to know what he has to say to these churches. And he's got a specific reason for picking out these churches. There was other churches, probably over 100 different churches at this point. And you've got a church in Rome, a church at Jerusalem, and other places. And it seems like that would be, a more prominent church maybe to send a letter to. But he's got a specific reason for choosing out these seven churches. They represent something. And we'll get into that in the next couple of chapters. But I want you to write down a message to them. Verse 12 says, "And I turned to see the voice that spake with me, and being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks." Now, this is not candlesticks like we think of candlesticks. Our candlesticks that we think of, if somebody says, "Hey, candlestick," we think of something made out of wax. It's got a wick in it. You light it, and it burns down. The wax melts off, and the thing burns down into nothingness, so you can't use it anymore. That's not the candlestick he's referring to. He's referring to more of a lampstand here. Probably something like a menorah that the Jewish people still use today. It's something made out of brass or gold or something else that you put oil in and you light it that way. So when you see candlestick here, don't think of something made out of wax. It's more of a prominent and permanent structure. And so there's seven golden candlesticks. And it tells us, verse 13, "In the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man." So right in the midst of it, he says there's one like the Son of Man, which is a messianic title of Jesus Christ. And it was his way to associate with mankind. It's a title he referred to himself more often than any other while he lived on this earth. And notice he says he's clothed with a garment down to the foot and girt about the paps with a golden girdle. And it is reminiscent of the way that he is described in the book of Daniel, chapter number 7, refers to him in much the same manner. For time's sake, we won't turn there, but you can check that out for yourself. It says his head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire. And Daniel 7, verse number 9 has something very similar. It says, "I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head like the pure wool. His throne was like the fiery flame, and his wheels as burning fire." Now, I want you to know what it says here. It says his eyes were as a flame of fire. They were not a flame of fire. So you see some of these paintings, they'll paint a literal picture of this representation. You know, it's fire shooting out of his eyes, a sword out of his mouth. It's like, and what he's saying is, you know, he's got the eyes of judgment on us. You know, as every single one of us has had a time where our parents has looked at us in that way. You know, get that look of judgment, that flame of fire. Maybe your spouse has looked at you like that before across the room. That flame of fire, that judgment. You better straighten up, because if you do not, you're in big trouble kind of look. And we already looked at, and we've looked in Hebrews that have talked about the fact, Hebrews 4, that all things are naked and open before him. We can't hide anything from the Lord Jesus Christ. He sees and knows all things, but he's got eyes of judgment here. Tells us in verse 15 that his feet like unto fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace, and his voice is the sound of many waters. Once again, brass is the idea of judgment. And his voice was as the sound of many waters. It kind of grabbed your attention. And when I think of, and I read this verse, I think of the different times my family's had to visit some different waterfalls. We took a vacation this year and we went up to Michigan, and we made our way up to the Upper Peninsula and around Lake Michigan, and we stopped along the way at different waterfalls. And you park and you've got to walk a trail. You can't even see water. But before you get to it and you can even see water, you hear the water. You hear the waterfalls. It gets your attention. You just kind of follow that sound in that direction. A few years back, I went to Niagara Falls for the first time. We went on a family trip. Drove overnight there to get to Niagara Falls. And when you go to Niagara Falls, you can hear the loud roar of water. But we went down to the Maid of the Mist, and we got in this boat. And I want to encourage you, if you ever go to Niagara Falls, you get on that, pay the money, go on the Maid of the Mist. I would never not go. Even though I've been on it before, I'd never not go to Niagara Falls and not get on the Maid of the Mist. You have to. And you get on that boat, and it takes you right up close to the falls. And you can just feel the power of the water that's rushing and falling, just the loud noise that just, you can't even hardly talk to each other. You gotta shout to be able to talk to each other. The water is so loud. And that's what I think of when I think and read verse number 15, is the sound of many waters. It's not some sort of muffled noise. It's very audible. He understands what's being said, but it is loud and it completely grabs your attention. There's nothing else to focus in on. And he had in his right hand seven stars. We'll talk about those stars in a minute. And out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword. And Hebrews 4:12 says, "For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, of the joints and marrow, and is the discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart." Now, the reason he wrote that down in Hebrews 4 was had to do with standing before him, him judging our motives of why we're doing what we're doing. And he says the word of God pierces down. He knows the thoughts and intents of our heart. It's a sort of judgment and discernment. That's the same word that's going out of his mouth here in Revelation chapter number 1, the sharp two-edged sword. Ephesians 6:17 says, "And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God." And so he has this sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength. And is reminiscent of a picture we get of the transfiguration while Jesus was here on this earth, as he met with Moses and Elijah there on the mountain. He's transfigured, and they're able to see his glory shines as the sun. And you notice here John's response. "And when I saw him," verse 17, "I fell at his feet as dead." And that will be our response as we stand before our judge. Whether it's Isaiah, Ezekiel, or anyone else, when you stand before your judge, there's no other response but to fall dead at his feet. Complete submission to our judge and to our Savior. And John falls at the Lord Jesus Christ's feet as if he were dead. "And he laid his right hand upon me, saying unto me, Fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and of death." Now, these are verses that you can use to witness to the Jehovah Witness. They recognize in verse 8, Alpha and Omega, beginning and the ending, as Jehovah God. Also verse 11, "I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last." They recognize that as Jehovah God. See, they say God, Jehovah God, God the Father is the main God, and then you've got lesser gods, and Jesus is one of those lesser gods, and you can become a god too. But you get here, and it says, "I am the first and the last." Now, they recognize that as Jehovah God said that, because Alpha and Omega called himself the first and the last in verse number 11. And so you ask him, in verse 18 there, "I am he that liveth and was dead." When did Jehovah God die? He didn't. It's the Lord Jesus Christ. He's saying, "I am Jehovah God. I am God." So we use this to witness to a Jehovah Witness. But he says, "Behold, I am alive forevermore." And of course, the resurrection of Jesus Christ is what makes our salvation possible. And because he conquered death, he has the keys of hell and of death. Verse number 18. In verse 19, he says, "Write the things which thou hast seen, and the things which are, and the things which shall be hereafter." And verse number 19 of chapter number 1 gives us the outline of the book of Revelation. He says, first of all, "Write the things which thou hast seen." That is the vision of the Lord Jesus Christ and that we just witnessed. I want you to write down the vision of Christ that's been given. I want you to write the things which are, and that is the letters to the churches. Write about the church age. And then I want you to write about the things which shall be hereafter. And that is chapters 4 through 22, the judgment that is to come, those things to come. So it gives us an outline of the book here, that vision of Christ, the church age, the letters to those churches, and then what comes after the churches, that judgment. And he says, the mystery of the seven stars. So we saw this vision, and now he's going to explain it to us. He's going to reveal it to us. The mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in my right hand, and the seven golden candlesticks. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. So let's go back and look what it says here. You go back and it tells us in verse 12 that being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. And so Jesus Christ tells us those seven golden candlesticks, that they are the seven churches. The churches that were listed up in verse 11. They're Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, Laodicea. Those are the seven golden candlesticks. And it's Jesus Christ who's standing in the middle of those seven churches. He is that one that was saw. Now, the scary thing about that is, as you get a glimpse of the Savior who's standing there, he's standing there in judgment. Eyes as a flame of fire, feet as brass. It all has to do with judgment. He is going to judge these churches. And as you get in and you read these letters to the churches, he says, I know your works. You can't hide anything from him. All things are naked and open before him. You can't hide it. So you have the judge standing in the midst of the churches, and we see that he has in his right hand, verse 16, these seven stars. And it tells us in verse 20, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. Now, I don't believe those are some sort of celestial being. That word angel there is the idea of a messenger. And I believe he's referring to the pastors and the elders and the leadership of those seven churches. He wants to deliver a message to those pastors to give to their people. And that's why he's going to say, like chapter 2, verse number 1, unto the angel of the church of Ephesus, write. Verse 12 says, unto the angel of the church in Pergamos, write. He's writing a message to those pastors to give to the congregation there. And so he's got these pastors and these churches in mind. And as we get into chapters 2 and 3, we're going to go a little bit slower and see what the message is that he has for each of these churches and how we can apply it to our own lives. We want to read it, we want to understand it, and do something with it.